you very much for joining Cinema Showcase tonight, and join me in welcoming back Robert Mitchum. It's a pleasure to have you here.
Thank you very much, Jim.
The Big Sleep, let me ask you, Philip Marlowe, the character, is probably one of the most famous of literary characters, and I wasn't sure when I heard that The Big Sleep had been changed from Los Angeles to London that it would work, but when I saw the picture, it does work.
Well, I had the same feeling, and I'm sure a lot of other people did. I know, I remember Sarah Miles, she carried the book with her all the time, and she kept referring to it. She wanted the decor in her bedroom changed because it did not follow the description, you know, Chandler's description of whatever her name is, her birth, her bedroom. Mm-hmm. And she was talking about, she's English, and I mean, why should she be so protective of the quality, you know, the standard of the aficionados of Raymond Chandler? I don't know. And as a matter of fact, I didn't know that he had that many followers. I knew very little about him, as a matter of fact. I had met him once when I was a kid. Thought he was very affected. And not knowing at that time that he had gone to a school in Dulwich, and he had been raised in England and Ireland, and I just thought he was a sort of a self-affected writer with a sort of upper-class accent. And later, after we finished the film, Michael Winner gave me a book on Raymond Chandler, and it's illustrated in part some of the machinery, the progressive development of Marlowe. And as a literary device, if you will, he took a man who's, there was a great deal of Chandler in Marlowe. Mm-hmm. And he, in pursuing a conclusion on an assignment, he is sort of regularly confronted by moral obstacles which he must deal with, and which I suppose illustrates his own morality. And I think it's a little freaky. I think he keeps throwing those broads out of his bed and silly things like that. But I think that every time the plot, and most detective stories get a little mixed up, and every time the plot got a little tangled, why, he brings forth another character, and again, another attendant moral problem. Mm-hmm. And in one fashion or another, he solves it, because I think the only time that there's any violence at all is as a sort of self-protective measure. There are some, I mean, involving other people, there are a few bizarre encounters. But I find that the character itself plays as well in London, you know, in a contemporary background, as in Los Angeles. I think what has developed as as an interest in the mystique of the genre of Los Angeles in the 30s and 40s, as illustrated, for instance, in Chinatown, mm-hmm. and which we recreated in Farewell, My Lovely, is not necessarily that important. It's not that important to the story. I mean, I remember for years I used to talk to producers about using Los Angeles as a background, and they, you know, looked at me like I was on fire. Mm-hmm. And now it's become very popular, and it's very convenient, mm-hmm. Lord knows, but at that time they thought it was unattractive and disinteresting, uninteresting. But it had a peculiar sort of decadent quality about it. And it's, you know, a vastly spread out city with no core, no central area. And it had that color of masonry that is peculiar to Southern California that we refer to as dead Spaniard. Mm-hmm. And kind of a hokey architecture, which is fast disappearing. And remember, it's just falling down and not being replaced.
Yeah.
And it had great charm, and I said, I should, you know, it was valuable, I'm sure, to introduce it to other people who did not live through it, mm-hmm. who did not experience it. And Chandler, who found it untenable and unlivable, because he was far more interested in what he considered a much more civilized society in England.
Well, he was a screenwriter for a while out there, wasn't he? He wrote, I know, the script for Double Indemnity and things like that.
Yeah, but he never liked it. He was never comfortable at it. Mm-hmm. And he felt, even when he was being recognized as a literary figure, not simply as a mystery writer, he still was, he felt unfulfilled, you know, that, because he was a very serious writer. Mm-hmm. And his greatest successes were in things of this sort. But he didn't think he was being taken very seriously. Mm-hmm.
That was the great thing, though, about, you're talking about the look Los Angeles had. That was the great thing about Farewell, My Lovely. One of the great things is it had such a look about it. Now, whether that was because of Dick Richards or...
I quarreled with that largely because I said, look, in 1940, a 1940 automobile was brand new, wasn't it?
Yeah.
And the house was freshly painted in 1940. Mm-hmm. And we're taking a look at it from 1975. That house that Sylvia Miles was in had not been painted since 1940. And the car was an old wreck. The suit that I had on was worn by Victor Mature in 1940. And the whole thing was kind of dog-eared and tattered, yeah, you know, a little decayed. But Johnny Alonso put it all together, and he photographed it through a glass darkly, and it provided an illusion. I mean, L.A. didn't look like that at that time. It felt like that, I promise you, really. It felt like it had it, you know.
But if we have to look at it from 75, I guess we have to look at it that way, don't we?
Well,
or at least in films.
It worked.
Yeah.
It worked. Yeah. I mean, after all, it is, you know, it's an audio-visual medium. Mm-hmm. And the visual portion was achieved through that effect, and it was really an effect. It was a movie effect.
Movie making can be fun.
Well, actually, it was enjoyable because of the characters, you know.
Yeah.
Mean.
This is Mr. Marlowe, General.
Sir, you're looking at a rather dull survival of a gaudy life. Brandy?
Thank you.
So you know Inspector Carson?
Our paths cross now and then.
No, he recommended you. He said you had that American quality of insubordination. What do you know of me?
Well, you're very rich. Your wife died several years ago and you moved to England.
No, sir. Meanwhile, I'm being blackmailed again. A year ago, I paid £5,000 to a man by the name of Joe Brody to leave my younger daughter, Camilla, alone.
I met her in the hall.
Yes, I'm afraid my girls have all the usual vices.
Thank you.
Let's talk for just a minute about Ryan's daughter, because this is a picture that I think at the time was regarded as an excellent film, and as time goes on will be thought of as even better than it was. And you were really cast somewhat against type. I know you've heard that many times. Looking back on it from after, what, 5 or 6 years, how do you view Ryan's daughter now? Is it...
Well, I find it very satisfying as a travelogue, really, the scenery is. I have a sense of nostalgia about it. And I enjoy it very much. I was there for 10 months, and I had the... David Lean found me really very difficult to understand because I was American, mm-hmm. And he that made him very nervous. And it was his choice.
Yeah.
When they first called me about it, I said, well, surely there are a lot of very good Irish actors out of work. Get one of those. No, you. And finally, he called me up. I unwittingly picked up the telephone on a Sunday afternoon. It was Bobby Bolt and David calling, I guess, from Ireland. And Bobby could not understand. I mean, I simply didn't want to go to work. It was a basic charge of laziness, that's all. And he said, what other plans have you? I said, I had planned suicide. No further questions, okay? And there's a small pause. And he said, if you would do this wretched film of ours and then do yourself in, he said, I'll be happy to stand the expense of your burial. I said, I'll do it, okay? And I'm glad I did. I enjoyed it.
Thank you.
Several people who have worked with Lean said that even though he is such a perfectionist, that he comes to the set really without much of an idea of how he's going to set up the shot.
Hasn't a clue. I couldn't believe that. And Robert Bolt has worked with him a great deal and works very closely with David, said David has no idea when he comes to work in the morning what he's going to do, and I couldn't believe that. You know, he's got $14 million riding on his back. We'd wander around sometimes for days before he would attempt a shot, and I said, why? And he said, well, David's very nervous about that. He's always afraid that he's going to, you know, line something up and set up a scene, and then people are going to look at each other and go, you know, he's going to be laughed at. And he's afraid. I said, that's nonsense. Come on, Sarah, let's do it. You know, yeah. We'd do it. David said, it seems to work all right, doesn't it? I said, why not, you know? But he has that strange hesitation, his fear to begin, you know?
Mm-hmm. Well, do you think then he's more a director interested in the visual aspects, or did you learn anything from him?
His talent as a visualist, as you know, mm-hmm. He's without peer, I think, really. And his... he's a very enormously sensitive man, and he finds that difficult to communicate, you know, because he feels as though he's probing into your own psyche, and he is very sensitive about that.
Mm-hmm.
So you have to, hopefully, you have to interpret that for him and display it to him, and then if he's pleased, good.
Yeah. You know, another very perfectionist sort of director you worked with several times was Vincent Minnelli. How would you contrast him with...
Well, I worked with Vincent the first time on Undercurrent with Kate Hepburn, and I came to work and he said, are those your own clothes? And they were kind of pinned up in the back, and I said, yeah. He disapproved, you know, because kind of hokey clothes. And that worked out very well because it was done with great taste. And then the second one was Home from the Hills, which was really, one would not think was Vincent's cup of tea. Because
mm-hmm.
we were working on the Sulphur River bottom outside of Paris, Texas. And it's a very physical background, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And dramatically, I mean, he was very well suited to it.
Yeah.
And... I see Vincent, I'm sure as everyone else does, with the whole Metro soundstage and the orchestra and the choreographers, and I'm sure he enjoys that a great deal more.
Mm-hmm.
But he works very, very hard, and he's a very cheerful man to work with, and I enjoyed it. I enjoyed working with him, and he does strive for perfection.
Mm-hmm. I think Home from the Hill, though, if I may say, has, I think, one of your very best performances in it, because it...
good character.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, yeah. You don't sell diamonds in the 5 and 10. You're only as good as the job.
Let me switch from directors, talking about directors, to some of your leading ladies. And there's one in particular I want to ask you about, since I remember very clearly 5 years ago I said I want to ask you about Deborah Carr, but I never got around to it. You've worked with her, I think, three or four times?
Three times, I think.
What
now, heaven knows,
like
Mr. Allison, on the Sundowners and on the Grass is Greener.
Yeah.
If I'd had it my way, I'd have started, I'd begun with her in films and never quit.
Yeah.
I could sit right here now and she could be in Switzerland. And we could make the picture on the phone. I mean it,
yeah.
With complete confidence in the other's response. We have such total rapport,
mm-hmm.
and such a mutual admiration society that really I think we're capable of conviction without ever seeing each other.
Mm-hmm. She hasn't made a film, and she says the reason she hasn't made a film in 5 or 6, 7 years is because the parts they're offering her are so beneath.
That's right. They, you know, she finds it so dreary being asked to play the tragic, unwanted woman.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I can understand that. You know, I wouldn't mind playing the tragic, unwanted woman. They don't offer me those parts, but she's far more versatile than that. She has great humor,
mm-hmm.
you know, and a very attractive lady, very bright. And I'm sure that eventually she'll find something that suits her and she'll
go
back to work.
I hope so. I really do.
I do too.
What films are you looking forward to in the future? Are you going to take some more time off now?
I haven't got a clue.
Really?
Never know.
What about Philip Marlowe? Would you like to do another Marlowe?
If they make it attractive enough.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I wouldn't. I don't rule it out. I just don't. I don't know that he wrote that many.
Yeah.
Essays about Philip Marlowe.
Well, you know, one great thing about your version of The Big Sleep is that at least we can understand it. I've heard that even the writers of the Bogart one weren't really sure what was going on.
I remember that quite well. They called Chandler, who at that time, it seems to me, I've got a thing about this, that he was living in some strange place like Oxnard, and he came into town, and a bunch of writers used to gather around a bookshop, and whoever got a royalty check would buy sparkling burgundy or buy a jug, you know, and that was the cause for a celebration. They get their mail there. Because they were unsure, you know, of steady employment.
Mm-hmm.
And Chandler had sold this script to Warner Brothers, and they called him and wanted him to come in and explain what this extraneous, sort of totally gratuitous body. I mean, who killed him? So we're sitting around talking it, drinking this California Red, and finally somebody like Jack Woodford said, do you know? And he said, I don't. You know, I said, well, tell him that. He said, I don't know. And that's the way it was left. We just simply dismiss it as suicide. Owen Taylor, the chauffeur.
Yeah.
Now why? Suddenly in the middle of a picture, a guy drives off the pier and who did it? Oh, we write, you know, suicide. Okay, next case, we don't attempt to solve it. At least Michael did make him culpable.
Yeah.
Because he kills Geiger, I think.
Yeah.
So.
I know somebody asked Jules Furthman, 15 years later why so-and-so happened in the big sleep. And he said, I really don't know.
No.
Why?
No. You just keep dazzling him with footwork, you know, don't bother me with details.
Of all the directors you've worked with, which ones, we've mentioned David Lean and Vincent Minnelli, which ones stand out to you as ones maybe you've learned something from or a really good experience?
Well, John Huston, yeah, certainly, and Bill Wellman, and a lot of guys that I used to work with, you know, we used to just crank them out, mm-hmm, like that, like Gordy Douglas, you know, and somebody would come up to Gordon and say, I feel that that the motivation of this, and Gordy say, roll it. Yes, yes, of course, I get in, you know, shoot it. He's anxious to get the show on the road, and let's get out of here. I remember working with Howard Hawks, and people said, Howard would stand for long periods of gazing off into space, and everybody would tiptoe around and say, he's writing, you know, that's when he's doing all his thinking, and he's plotting out the thing. I watched him one time. He's standing there when everyone's very silent, and Howard is gazing off into space like this, and finally he looks around like this. Just wants to know if it's time to break, that's all. Get out.
He's writing. That's good. That's,
yeah, good. When he called me about doing El Dorado, I was in Chicago, and he called me up. So I said, that's on. He said, what about a Western, you know, with Duke Wayne? I said, fine. I said, what's the story? He said, oh, no story, Bob. No story. Just character. He said, people don't want to see stories. They get bored with stories. Character. I said, why not?
Through sunshine and shadow, from darkness till noon, over mountains that reach from the sky to the moon, a man with a dream that will never let go, keep searching to find El Dorado. So ride, only ride to the end of the rainbow. Ride, only ride till you find El Dorado. The winds become bitter, the sky turns to gray, his body grows weary, he can't find his way, but he'll never turn
What about Walsh, Royal Walsh?
Oh, great, great, great. I had to break out of a little box canyon and make a sharp right turn barebacking on a horse. And so we did it. And Ralph said, could you bring him out faster? He said, I said, okay. So one of the wranglers was back there with a switch. They call action. And meanwhile, they had set another camera up there, which I did not know, but the horse certainly didn't know about that. And they whacked the horse, and I bent them around the corner like this. And the horse saw this camera, and he spooked, and I went down. The horse rolled over on me, just rolled right over in the sand. Yeah. And Ralph came over, and he said, you want to do it again faster? He didn't ask me if you got broken ribs or, you know, or you mashed it. Said, let's try it again.
Try it again faster.
Yeah, and this time the horse will know that the camera's there, and bring him out a little faster. Marvelous guy, really.
Ah, great.
He had the greatest rip off the piece. He'd start a scene. They'd say action. He'd say action. He'd turn around and walk away. And he rolled a cigarette with one hand. He used to roll Bull Durham cigarettes on this blind side. Mm-hmm. And all the tobacco would fall out. The paper would just go, psh, like that. He'd roll another one. Finally, when everything was quiet, he'd say, is it over? Cut it. Is it? How was it? He'd say, well, okay. A lamp fell down. Looked natural? Fine. Okay. Rip the page out. On to the next one.
That's like Spencer Tracy's advice to young actors, you know, learn your lines and don't bump into the furniture.
That's right.
We are all out of time. Thank you, Bob.
Thank you.
Great pleasure. Thanks.